this one old couple in their 70s standing off to the side. They weren't offended. They were astonished. Their wildest fantasies of what was about to take place when they visited the French Quarter was coming true, right? But I wasn't the only one who noticed them. One of the West Georgia grad students also noticed them. And he went over to them, and he invited them to do something beyond their wildest fantasies. Yes, he invited them to join the dance, and they did. These people in their 70s with their suits and curls dancing on Bourbon Street with us. So at that point, I realized that there was a predilection that this group had that was very special, a capacity, a predilection to flourish and to invite others to flourish in improvisational, spontaneous, wondrous ways. So I came here, and once I got here, I saw that in much better detail. The town of Carrollton isn't what you see today. They'd ripped out the square. The downtown had died. Nothing was there. A loan shark, maybe. Everything else was plywood boarded up, nothing. Nobody went there because there was nothing to go there for. But a pair of West Georgia alums brought the square back. Lenny and Star Miller. They started Mayfest and brought everybody to Mayfest. And Mayfest was something for everybody. They had soapbox derby races and dances and gymnastics, whatever class you were in, you know, you came and did your thing there on the square as part of Mayfest. Then they had a Maypole where you every pagan ritual, every Christian ritual, every ritual was part of Mayfest. And it drew people back to come back to the square. And then they got grants to bury the silly wires, and then they got grants to plant the trees, and then they got grants to put in bricks and benches, and then gradually businesses started coming back to the square. And that was part of the predilection for improvisational change toward greater flourishing for the whole community. And I saw so many examples of that. It's a West Georgia alum that started recycling in America, that started a farmer's market, that started community-supported agriculture. So, as I watched this in the 80s, of course, I got very interested in how did this begin? How did it begin to grow? So, I made a point to really discover the origin. And now, I'm the last one left. Who can tell it? So let me tell you how it began. Of course, it begins in the mid-60s, when this was a much smaller place. I think there were only three people in the psych department, one of whom was Jim Thomas, who, for reasons beyond today's thought, decided that heuristic psychology was the way to go. He was trained as a behaviorist. But he wanted to change his place in the humanistic program. And he knew that Maslow was a pioneer in this old chain. So he had the audacity to write Maslow and said, you know, we could use a new chair here. We want somebody to bring what you're doing here. Who would you recommend we hire? And I was just talking with an alum who was in his office, showing him the letter he was going to send to Maslow. And the person I was talking with said, he was impressed that Jim thought he could just write Maslow and Maslow would answer him. But Maslow did answer him. And with a very clear recommendation. He said, Mike Ahrens is your guy. You need to get Mike. And so they contacted Mike, offered him the chair job. He came down from Brandeis with a bunch of faculty, a plan for a master's program, and 40 new courses to add to the catalog, and that's 50 years ago. But now, what I really want to tell you about is how it happened that Mike was available to come down here and do that at that point in time. And this is where the story gets very strange. The synchronicities, the serendipities, the whatever you want to call it, that got us all here is much weirder than you probably know. So, and you know it's pretty weird. But okay, let me tell you that story. Because, you know, he was quickly labeled back in the day before these labels were so diagnostic and educable. He was retarded. Like Aaron's. Well, how did that happen? Well, every time the teacher would ask him something, he'd go, huh, what? But Mike's experience was that 10 minutes before that, the teacher was talking about X. And so Mike started thinking of all these other things about X. So he's still spinning out all these things about X while the teacher's gone on to Y and Z. And now the teacher interrupts his reflection on X, tell me about Z. He goes, huh, what? But because he was seen as retarded and uneducable, they sent this Jewish kid from Detroit down to a military boarding school in rural Georgia, in Barnesville, where they hoped he would manage to get through high school, and then that was going to be it, no more education for life. And he did manage to get through high school and came back to Detroit with no future other than selling the vacuum cleaners at Sears, and then he decided to drive a taxi. So in his mid-20s, he's a taxi cab driver. But at the end of one of these days of driving his cab, he looks back at the back seat, and one of his fares had left a book back there. So he picks it up and sees what it is. It's Viktor Frankl's message. He reads it and decides, wow, I really want to learn more about this. So he decides he's going to go to college, even though everybody's told him, forget it, you can't possibly do it. Late in his 20s, he goes to the State University in Detroit, Wayne State, which at that time would take you if you can get in. So he gets in and he goes. He goes to Wayne State in the late 50s to learn existential psychology, not realizing that, of course, nobody's teaching existential psychology in the 50s in America. It's this weird beatnik thing that, you know, is coming out of Europe and nobody in the United States is going to take it seriously in academia. Except that, when he got to Wayne State, there was a visiting professor that came that year from Italy whose specialty was existentialism. And so he gets this amazing education in existentialism at Wayne State from Giamacco, who really turned Mike on to learn everything. You know, he just caught fire and just absorbed everything. And so he has this wonderful education, at the end of which he goes to Giamacco and confides to him that what he'd really like to do now is to go to the Sorbonne, go to Paris, the epicenter of existentialism, and learn it from Sartre and Merleau-Ponty and de Beauvoir and Ricoeur and all those people there. And Giamacco nods and says, that sounds like a good idea. And Mike looks at him like he's from Mars and goes, what are you talking about? I could never get into the Sorbonne. And even if I could, I couldn't afford it. And even if I could, I don't know French. And Giamacco looks at him and says, Arons, what's with these details? Just go. So he does. Makes just enough money to get on some cheap ship and learns just enough French and goes to study existentialism under Merleau-Ponty in 1961 at the Sorbonne. He gets there just weeks after Merleau-Ponty died. But he ends up then working with Paul Ricoeur, who actually was a much better fit for what Mike was into. Although at the time when Mike first talks to Paul, he says what he'd really like to do is a psychology of creativity. Because at this point, early 60s, the United States is all dominated by behaviorism. Behaviorism sees the whole psychological trip as reproduction. You know, the impact of causal factors from stimuli from the world just making you reproduce whatever the SRRs are. So he wants to study creativity as the antidote to that vision of the psychological. So Ricoeur says, well, I've got bad news and good news. The bad news is there is no such word as creativity in the French language. It existed as an adjective, but not as a noun. But then he said, but the good news is, I'm on the dictionary revision committee. We are on to the C's, so I will just add it as an amendment.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, talk about being in the right place at the right moment. You couldn't arrange it.
No.
But so anyway, he's doing his dissertation on creativity. He marries Christiane. The two of them figure they're going to have an adventure. He could write his dissertation from anywhere. So they decide they're going to go teach English to Africans in a French colony in sub-Saharan Africa, what's now Gabon. So they go down there, live in a hut in the jungle with the monkeys, and are teaching English at the school and having the adventure of a lifetime while he's writing this dissertation on creativity. And he writes 4,000 pages. My dissertation was awfully long, and it was one-tenth that size, so you understand, this is big. But after he's written a 4,000-page dissertation on creativity, he looks at it and decides it's junk. And so he throws it away.
Oh no.
And writes Harukura a letter saying, thank you so much for the confidence you had in me. I am so sorry to disappoint you, but I'm just not going to be able to finish. So I'll have to resign as a graduate student. Sends him the letter. He and Christiane are now free to just do whatever they want to do. So they decide they're just going to travel. So they leave Africa for Eastern Europe. And of course, aren't in Gabon when the letter comes back from Harukura. But somebody in Gabon knew that they would be in Hungary and forwards the letter to them in Hungary. But by the time it gets to them in Hungary, they're in Prague. But somebody in Hungary has enough sex to know they're in Prague and forwards the letter to Prague. But by the time it gets to Prague, they're not there anymore, they're in Vienna. Somebody in Prague knows where they're going to be in Vienna. But by the time it gets there, they're not in Vienna, they're in Berlin. But somebody in Vienna forwards it to them in Berlin, and it finally catches up to them the day before the date that Paul Ricoeur had invited them to come to his house for dinner. Now, Mike knew that this French professorship system was such that professors don't invite their students to the house for dinner. And he understood this was a really big thing that Paul Ricoeur was doing for him. So they hurried across the continent to get to the house just in time for the dinner. And at the dinner, Ricoeur looks at Mike and says, so, Aaron, you like chess, yes? Mike says, yes. And he says, so why don't you just do this? Just go and do the Latin Quarter. The Latin Quarter in Paris is what the French Quarter is every place else, right? That's where the existentialists hung out. That was the place, right? So, why don't you just go into the Latin Quarter and play chess for a while? After a while, your dissertation will come back to you. And when it does, you'll write it. And when you do, I'll approve it, and you'll get your degree. Just go play chess until it. So Mike does. And his dissertation comes back to him, and he writes it, and he gets his doctorate for the savant. And then he comes back to the States and ends up with Maslow at Brandeis. And that's how the connection happened, that when Jim Klee contacted Maslow, oh, Mike's your man, I want this guy. And that's how it all started here. So, what do we owe this place to then? Well, you could say Mike, you could say Viktor Frankl, you could say that guy who left the book in the taxi cab. You could go back and back and back, and it's all interconnected in the most bizarre way that, of course, life is, right? Or to put it the way I started, I think what's so magical about this place is that ability to be present to that upsurging of improvisational possibilities that you can engage when you're free to be fully available to what comes to you. And that's the magic of the last 50 years here. Thanks.